449, I know that everyone knows, 449, Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me.
Thank you for all that. afternoon he's going to be speaking on why the Catholic Church does not dismiss the pedophiles priests. And he talked to me a little bit about it. And every time I talk to him, he has studied well, prepared well. He always has an excellent, excellent message when he speaks. And so he's going to come and give that to us this afternoon, and just thank God that this man can, at his age, you know, I get where I can't study. My brain shuts down. I'm serious. I get into something, I get really excited about it. I grab it real quick, and we're on the board. And so he stays with it. And he's got the message for us today. So, are you going to say the same thing?
No, I'll have him sing in a minute.
All right.
I'm going to talk for a minute here now. Thanks. I told him I'll call him here in a minute. Okay. All right. Thank you very much. Thank you so much. I tell you, this has been a great meeting. I don't know when we've had a better meeting.
Amen.
It's just been a marvelous, marvelous meeting. And I'm awfully sorry about Brother Nuttall. I told him where he can get it over the internet, and I'm hoping that he'll be able to watch over the internet. There's so many things that, you know, when they take your picture and you got your mouth wide open, it doesn't look very good. And most of the time, that's the way that's the way they find it. You know, usually my mouth wide open. I appreciate every one of you that has come. I appreciate Brother Homer and his fine church being willing to host this meeting again.
Yeah.
It seemed like that several of our men had things this time that just absolutely kept them from coming. Brother Dan Harden is working diligently to get into a new church building, and they're under the deadline trying to get out of their old building, get into a new church building. And Brother Johnny Gerald, he was scheduled to speak tomorrow evening, first speaker tomorrow evening, and he's scheduled for knee replacement this week. And we need to be much in prayer for him. Brother Ernie Sanders was coming. He was scheduled to speak. And he's having throat surgery. They think it's benign. They don't think it's cancerous. But he's having some kind of throat surgery. He's going to be out of commission for about 2 weeks. So we need to be much in prayer for him. And there were two or three of the other men that had emergency situations. And so every year, of course, there's always something. But we're glad for new men. We appreciate Brother Tom Chestnut bringing his brother Earl. And Brother Earl, we appreciate your coming with Brother Tom. You've been to the meetings in Indianapolis before. And Brother Joy Foss brought Brother Chopek with him. Now, let me have that. What do I do with that? Oh, here it is right here. Brother Chopek, stand up, Brother Chopek, back there for just a moment. Brother Chopek came with Brother Joy. He's one of his near men. And he's developed this program called Beyond the Grid, or Beyond Off-Grid, rather, Return to the Old Paths. And he's got a website that you can go to find all about it. And there's a documentary film about surviving and thriving in our uncertain modern world. Now, he's got some of these brochures right out here on the table out here, of course. These brochures, they're free of charge, of course. And then on the back, he's got more information. So be sure and pick one of these brochures up. And they put a great deal of time and effort and finances into this project. And you can pick one of these up and you can go to this website and find out more about it. Now, if you'll forgive me, while Brother Bob comes to sing here in a moment, I'm going to put my coat on because we come up here from Florida and we've traded about between 20 and 30 degrees. And I, to be honest with you, I'm about freezing it. And I'm going to put my coat on and I'm going to preach in my coat. So if you don't mind, regardless of how it may look, I'm going to put this coat on, if you don't mind. All right.
Well, you know, we've heard a lot of trials, but a lot of different trials and things that folks have been through. Have you ever wondered why? Have we ever just stopped and wondered, Lord, why have you brought us this way? Well, the one thing that we need to know for sure, that the way God knows the path, that he's taken each and every one of us.
Amen.
And he makes no mistakes.
That's right.
Amen. Brought you this far in life's way. Yeah.
preacher asked me some time ago, prior to when Brother Grove passed away, when we were up there in that area one time, thanks. Turn that up now. Thank you.
Who wants you comfortable?
Amen.
Okay, turn that up, so I'll take you. Anyway, he asked me, he said, would you write out a bibliography of books that you would recommend for preachers to read? And I thought a lot about that, and I've never done it, but I need to do it. And of course, one of them would be the Constitution of the United States, of course. However, I constantly get books, and one book that I got a hold of just recently is a book from the Voice of the Martyrs. This was given to me as a gift, entitled Extreme Devotion, and it has 365 little devotionals in it about various martyrs, not only present-day martyrs, but ancient martyrs. And there's one in here for day 184 that I read that frankly just sort of blew me away. And I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I'm going to read a couple of sentences. A little girl said to her father, and I quote, I want to talk to you about an unusual gift. Said the Chinese father to his beautiful black-haired daughter. She smiled with anticipation. She loved it when her wise father shared special lessons about God, and so on and so forth. He opened a worn Bible and began. And I want you to turn to the first chapter of Philippians, please. Now, I don't know how many times I've read this verse. And I've got it underlined. But I'm not sure that I ever saw it. I'm sure I've read it, because it's underlined. But I'm not sure I ever saw it. You know what I mean by that, don't you?
Yeah.
I'm sure I've never preached on it. At least an entire message. Textual message. He opened his worn Bible and began. This gift is found in Philippians 1:29. Now here's what it says. It talks about two gifts. For unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on Him.
Yeah.
So if we have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, that we have received a gift from Him, right?
That's right.
Amen.
Not only has He given to us the gift of Himself as a sacrifice on the cross, but if we have believed on Him, He has given to us the gift of faith.
That's right.
Now that is an incredible thought. Almost beyond comprehension. But then it says, but also to suffer for His sake.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
I like that first gift.
Yeah.
I'm not sure I like that second gift. According to this, which was written under the inspired pen of the Holy Spirit given to the apostle of the Gentiles, to us, to the church at Philippi. And by the way, are you aware that Philippians was one of the prison epistles? Now you women, don't start fanning. I just got comfortable and you started fanning on me. Bless you. Well, Brother Hoover, have to turn down the air conditioner now. You're getting me guilty preaching on suffering and making you start thinking. Here's one of the prison epistles. And Paul said that suffering is a gift from our blessed Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. My friend, that's such a serious thought that beyond my comprehension. And so I leave that with you, that when we suffer with Him, that we are made partakers of the sufferings of Christ. Brother Joe, I see you back there in the condition you're in. Others that have suffered far greater than I've suffered. My dear wife, she's in bed 14 to 16 hours a day. I don't know why. And yet I can say to you, that is, according to what the scripture says, it is a gift. It is a gift. Suffering is a gift from our Lord Jesus Christ. Since we are chronicling some of these events from Nebraska, I want to go back and visit Nebraska for just a moment before I continue today, because if I don't, we'll never get this on the record. I want to go back a moment to that motel room when I said to Brother Ed Rowe, "Brother Ed, some mother's son is going to die today." Shortly after that, it wasn't too long, I suppose about 10 o'clock in the morning, I received a phone call, maybe around 9 o'clock in the morning, I received a phone call. I'm not going to give any names. All of these names are written in my journal. I'm not going to give those names this morning because there were several men, and I would, first of all, I would miss some of them, and if I'm going to name one, I would want to name all of them. They were some very, very important men, not only pastors, but men who were in the field of Christian education. Great leaders, one from Denver, other great men of God, and I'm sincere when I say they were great men of God. They came into my motel room. When they came into my motel room, they came for one purpose. They came to try to get me to try and get Brother Sullivan to work out a compromise. The compromise was to get Brother Sullivan to move the little Christian school across the line into the state of Iowa. I remember Brother Sullivan was still in jail at this time. And the compromise was to get me to go to Brother Sullivan to the jail and get him to try to move, and for me to try to persuade Brother Sullivan to move the little Christian school across the state line into Iowa. First of all, I certainly had no authority to do such a thing. Now, one of the most amazing things that ever took place, I never dreamed would take place. Just at that moment, Ron Bowman, who was the pastor out in California, where Tim Lee was in that revival meeting, rolled Brother Tim Lee through my motel room door, pushing Brother Tim Lee into my motel room, just at that second. And he sat there and listened to those men making that proposition to me. And when he had a lull in the conversation, he broke in. It was as if those men didn't even exist, as if they weren't even in the room. And he looked at me and he said, "Brother Dixon," and he repeated that statement. He said, "I went 8,000 miles away from home to lose these two legs for a less cause than this." And he said, "I've come, set a revival meeting down, and I've flown 3,000 miles across this country, and I've come to Nebraska to cut the chains off of that church door." Well, when those men heard him say that, it was just like that woman that was taken in adultery. Yeah. Now, there were several of those men. And beginning at the eldest to the youngest, Brother Wiley, they vacated.
Wow.
And left that motel room. Now, that's when Brother Ed Rowe and I and Roy Thompson left to go see the judge, Judge Case. And then Tim left and went with the fellows, and they went to cut the chains off the church door. That's when I knew that I had to see that we had to see the judge, because I knew that somebody was going to get killed. And we went to find the judge to keep them from getting killed. And then you know the rest of the story. But I neglected to tell you that because I wanted you to hear that part of the story. Now, David Porter called me. David had planned to be here. And again, David's not here because the pastor where he was supposed to be in the revival meeting got confused on his dates. And so David had to end up going and preaching, starting a meeting tonight that he didn't realize that he had. He wanted to be here. I've never heard David literally shook. Now, David's almost childlike with this tumor. Many of you know that. And I'm not putting him down. I mean, you understand the context in which I'm saying. When he gets up to preach, I mean, he just preaches marvelous sermons. But when you're with him, many times he's almost childlike. And when he called me the other night, he was just, it was almost pitiful. And he said, "Brother Dixon," he said, "do you believe that we're," he said, "do you believe that we're at the end of the world?" He said, and he had a panic in his voice. He said, "Do you believe that the Lord's coming soon?" He said, "Do you believe that we're at the end?" And it was almost like he was at the panic stage. And I said, "Well, Brother David," I said, what do you mean?" Well, he said, those preachers in Houston, he said, "those preachers." And he was referring to the preachers that had received the subpoena. By the way, I have that subpoena. I'm not going to take time to get into that subpoena, but I have it here. And you need to study that. You can get on the internet. It's amazing. The subpoena that she sent those preachers. You need to study that. And the basis of that subpoena. Brother Boyd's son is there in Houston, pastor. And this is an interesting case. And even though the Attorney General of Texas has come out and said that it doesn't meet constitutional grounds, that subpoena has not been revoked yet. And the boldness of what this lesbian mayor has done. But the consequences of what the city of Houston did in electing her. See, that's what is horrible to think about. The consequences of their actions. And David was, this thing had just affected him to the very core of his being. And it should affect all of us.
Right.
You see. I said, David, I said, and I quoted what Jesus said. This is the beginning of sorrows.
Right. Amen.
David, this is just the beginning of sorrows.
Yeah.
I said, they haven't missed a meal. David. Every one of them is going to sleep in a soft bed tonight, Brother David. One of them is going to go home to Mama tonight, David. You know what I'm talking about, people?
Yeah.
I walked into a restaurant, Brother Vance, in Detroit, Michigan, some time ago. Preacher, I could tell he was a fundamentalist. He was sitting at the lunch counter, had a great big King James Bible, a big one. It was laid out. And I said, praise God. He was doing his devotions in a restaurant, sitting there by himself. And I thought, well, I'll meet him. Walked up, introduced myself. And it wasn't long, and he told me where he was pastoring. He was rejoicing that his church had just voted. Hello. You got to get the picture. Here's a man who just got up here and told us that his church told him, go come back tonight. This preacher told me that his church had just voted the night before to give him a 40 an ale. Do you know what a 40 an ale is? You grew up in Detroit. You know what a 40 an ad is? Yeah, you know what a 40 an ad is? That's what they get. That's what all the automobile workers in Detroit get. They get a 40 an ad. 40 years and they're out with a pension. And he was rejoicing. The men said in the business meeting, Pastor, we all get a 40 an ad. We think you ought to get a 40 an ad. We're going to give you a 40 of that. We're going to get 40 years. We can give you a pension, then you're out. Well, now, where did you find that in the Bible?
Yeah. Tell me more. I got 40 years in here.
Watch it. You may be out without a pension.
That's where it goes.
No, David. No, David. No, we're not to the end yet. This is the beginning of sorrows, David. Don't be feeling sorry for those preachers in Houston Thank God, David. Praise the Lord, David. It's just a beginning of a wake-up call, David. We've been warning them now for 30 years, David. Hallelujah, David. No. No, David. Don't worry. They're not going to do anything to them. You think they're going after 40 preachers at a time? No. They pick them off one at a time.
Right.
They go after a little tiny church in Louisville. Only a stupid lesbian mayor would be dumb enough to go after 44 churches at a time. Amen?
Amen.
The devil's not even that dumb. Right? No, no, David, don't. No. Go sleep and have a good night's sleep, David.
Yeah.
I want to play a CD for you. It's 3 minutes. Okay? Because I want you to hear. Now, I've gotten into CD books for there. It's better to listen to Limbaugh. And I enjoy Limbaugh. But it's enjoyable. It's better to listen to the radio. And you go to the library and they've got all these CD books right now. And I'm listening to The Mayflower by CD Book. I went and got the book. This is the book, The Mayflower. This is one of the greatest books on the Mayflower. But I'm listening to the CD book. Put it in, drive around, listen to the whole book on CD. Tremendous. I'm telling you, we're stuck in this. It's amazing. CD book. While you're driving, listen to stuff. Now, I went to the library the other day, and I saw college course on Catholic history, church history. 5 CDs. Huh. Got them? Nope. Didn't cost anything. Pop them in. I took a course in Catholic Church history. Wow, what did I learn? I learned why the Catholic Church doesn't excommunicate pedophile priests. I was wondering why they didn't excommunicate these pedophile priests. And I always wondered why, if there's a law that you're supposed to report child molesters, how comes these superiors to these priests don't go to jail and not arrested for not reporting these child molesting priests? How come? There has to be a reason. And I kept wondering, I thought about this for a long time. And here's a Catholic professor at Genesee Catholic University, Genesee, New York, one of the most reputed Catholic professors in America, has credentials longer than my arm, teaching these students at the Catholic University, and he just explains the whole thing. I said, wow, now I know why I'm a Baptist. I always thought I knew, and now I really know. But I'm just going to play you about 3 minutes, because I just want you to hear with your own ears. It's not that particular part, because that's another thing, but I want you to hear just the beginning of one of these CDs about the beginning of the reign of the marriage of Constantine and the church. Okay? And while I'm doing this, Brother Bob, will you get one of my books out of that box out there? In fact, will you bring that whole box of books in here, please? Thank you very kindly. You just start this and play it right now. Thank you very much. start over.
What's your point? Peace between empire and church. In his Inferno, Dante wrote these words. O Constantine, what evil did you sire? Not by your conversion, but by the dower that the first wealthy father got from you. Those words, written about 1,000 years after Constantine, the emperor, became Christian, really are important as a way of looking at the story of today's lecture, the examination of the church in the 4th century as it went from being a small, persecuted minority to becoming a privileged majority. Because although it's obviously good news that so many more people embrace Christianity, at least if you're a Christian, it is, there's also some bad news. The church changed. It changed in some way quite radically. And I think in retrospect, people would say, despite all the advantages of this free and open, growing Christianity, there are also some things that were lost from those early Christian days that are sad for the church to see pass away. So perhaps we can say about the 4th century, the words of Charles Dickens in a very different context. For Christians, the 4th century was the best of times, and also perhaps the worst of times. Let's examine a little bit that process of the changes that took place in Christianity in the course of the 4th century. You will remember that at the end of the 3rd century, during the reign of the Emperor Diocletian, came the worst persecution of all those persecutions in the early Christian centuries. That if we look today and say, who were the great Christians, who are the famous Christians of the beginning of the 4th century, the answer is virtually all a list of martyrs, some of whom we talked about in a previous lecture. If we ask, on the other hand, who are the most famous, the greatest, the most influential Christians of the end of the 4th century, we get a very different answer. Theologians, bishops and popes, and in fact, even the emperors of Rome. Let's remember what that persecution of Diocletian consisted of. The idea was to get rid of Christianity. And the method was simply to say to every Christian, turn over your books and get a certificate that says you have, in fact, sacrificed to the Roman gods. And we saw that there were many who refused to do that and who died. We talked about some of them in a previous lecture. I mentioned Saint Sebastian, for example, but there are just so many. I think of Saint Lucifer.
Okay, thanks. That's what I want you to hear. We're going to have to turn that air down, brother. We got it's too high now. When the women start fanning, I want them to be comfortable. Thanks, brother. Okay, I want you to get these books out to everyone. Someone help me get these books out to everybody, please. I want everybody to take one of these books. Now, you don't have to buy a book. If you want a book, they're $5. If you don't want a book, just turn them in afterwards. Just put them on the seat and we'll collect them afterwards. Let me have a book, brother. Let me have a book. Thanks. All right. Thank you very kindly. I want to show you something in this book, okay? Everybody take a book real quick. We're going to use it as a textbook, okay? Now, while he's getting out the book, I'm going to tell you why the Roman Catholic Church does not excommunicate these pedophile priests. This is exactly what he said. It's because they believe in apostolic succession. I gotta take a little drink on this. I want for a moment. I want you to get it. Because they believe in apostolic succession. Now, what did the Lord Jesus Christ say? Brother Paul? What did the Lord Jesus Christ say in Matthew chapter 16? He said, upon this rock, I will build my what?
Church.
Is that what he said, Brother Paul? Well, according to the Roman Catholic Church, he said, upon this rock, I will build my apostle. According to what he said. Because they believe in apostolic succession. Now, if you don't get this, you ain't got it. Because they believe that all of the authority rests in the apostles.
Yeah.
Did you ever hear of the Apostles' Creed? They quote it every Sunday. They quote it in the Anglican Church every Sunday. They quote the Apostolic Creed. Now, what is the Protestant churches? When they broke from the Roman Catholic Church, they said, we do not believe in apostolic succession. They said, we believe in three things. Sola Scriptura, sola fide, faith only. All right, sola Scriptura, faith only, sola fide, Scriptura, Scriptures only, faith only. What was the third thing?
Sola grace.
What?
Sola grace.
I didn't hear you.
Sola grace.
Okay, now. So they said, we believe in doctrinal authority. So they broke from apostolic authority and said, we believe that when the Lord Jesus said, upon this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. That he was talking about doctrinal succession. Well, big deal. That's where most Baptist churches are today. That's why they're comfortable in taking Baptists off the church now. They say, well, we're Baptist. We're Baptist in doctrine because we believe in doctrinal succession. That's what the Nazarenes believe. That's what the Methodists believe. That's what the Holiness believe. That's what every Protestant denomination believes. They believe in doctrinal succession. Because they will tell you that what they believe is what the apostles believe. They will tell you that what they believe is what Jesus taught. Because they believe in doctrinal succession. But that's not what Jesus said. He said, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. We believe in church succession. Now here's exactly, I got one amen. Listen. Listen to me. Here's exactly what this Catholic professor said. He said the reason that the Roman Catholic Church cannot excommunicate pedophile priests is because if they would excommunicate pedophile priests, they would unbaptize all of the people that they have baptized. Therefore, they cannot excommunicate them because of apostolic succession. Now, is there anything that I have not said that you do not understand what I just said? Brother Vance, let me ask you this question. If you had baptized that man that morning, and they had fired you that afternoon, would he have still been baptized? Would he? Is it your authority that you baptize him under?
That's right.
Beg pardon?
Churches.
No.
Church.
It's the authority of the church. Right?
Right. Right.
Right.
Now do you understand the difference?
Yeah.
My friends, there's a vast difference. Now, I want you to take your books, please. And I want to try to help you understand. Turn, please, to chapter 3. Well, first of all, I want to show you just a cursory. Turn to the table of contents on Roman numeral 5. Now, you know the old saying, you break it, you pay. So as long as you turn it back in and it's clean, you don't have to pay for it. But if you spit on it, you write on it, you pay $5, okay? All right, turn to Roman numeral 5. All right. Look at chapter 1. The trail of blood. All right, in chapter 1, we give the trail of blood. The reason we call this the trail of blood revisited is because this takes up from where J.M. Carroll's little book, The Trail of Blood, leaves off. We pick up where his little book leaves off. Okay? Now, in chapter 2, religious late liberty, a major tenet of the Baptists. Now look, folks. This book right here will explain to you that the Baptist got a bad rap. When you read David Barton, when you read all of the writers of the books on the founding of our country as far as liberty is concerned, even David Gibbs, they will tell you that the Protestants are the ones that gave us our liberty. They were not. The First Amendment is a Baptist amendment.
Right.
Roger Williams was banished. He was banished from Plymouth Colony. He was banished in the cold winter with nothing. except an overcoat. And a few pieces of bread in his overcoat in a cold winter night. If it hadn't been for the Indians, he wouldn't have survived.
Right.
And he made his way to what he later called Providence, Rhode Island. Even when the Constitution of the United States was ratified, Rhode Island was the only state that didn't have to ratify it. They ratified it, but they were the only state that didn't have to make any changes in their state constitution in the area of liberty. John Adams, when Isaac Backus challenged them, you know what John Adams said? He said, "Why, you might as well change the course of the sun and the sand in the heavens as to get Massachusetts to change their laws in the area of liberty." Speaking of religious liberty. In other words, it ain't going to happen. But it did. The Pilgrims and the Puritans persecuted the Baptists. Put them in jail. Hung them high. And then when Prince Philip, the Indian, lined up with all the Indians and they were about to drive the Puritans and the Pilgrims into the sea, it was the Baptists that came over and saved their necks. And the historians, this historian here, doesn't even give the Baptists credit. You've got to go get Phil Stringer's book to find out that the Baptists had anything to do with it. Now go to chapter 3. Go to chapter 3. In chapter 2, I just want to mention chapter 2 for just a moment. Listen to me. Until the First Amendment of the United States Constitution, there was no freedom of religion in the history of the world. Israel had a state church. It's Judaism. Until the First Amendment, until that Baptist Amendment, soul liberty. There was not a nation on the face of the earth nearly 6,000 years of history that ever had anything but a state church until the Baptists wrote that First Amendment. Until John Leland, a Baptist preacher in Virginia, influence James Madison to go to that Continental Congress and to work toward the First Amendment to the United States Constitution. We never had religious liberty in 6,000 years of human history. Never. You know what that means? It means up until that First Amendment, we always had to have a legal church. It means that we had religio legitio, religious, legitimate religion. And it meant that if you had religio legitimo, that you'd be persecuted. It means you had to get a license. You just heard what the man said. Constantine and the church got married. Then the church wasn't persecuted anymore. Why? Because it was legal. It was legal. It was legal. They weren't persecuted any longer. Not by taxes alone. They were legal. Why do you think they came after the Baptist temple? We weren't legal any longer. When we were legal, see, when you're legal, you get to pay taxes. Isn't that wonderful? Mm-hmm. When you're legal, you get to pay taxes. When you're illegal, then you don't have to pay taxes anymore. See? So when we were an illegal church, we stopped paying taxes. So they came after us because they wanted us to pay the taxes. See? Now look at chapter 3 here real quick. I want you to see this real quick. I want you to see the three kinds of churches that exist today in America. There's three kinds of churches. I've gone over this before, but there's new people here. Okay? Look on page 22. Okay? Look on page 22. Now, there are only three possible positions on the doctrine of the church. There's only three. You have to either take the Catholic position, which is the universal visible church, or the Protestant position, which is a universal invisible church, or the biblical or the Baptist position, which is the local visible church. Now those are the three positions. All right? Now, look at page 24. Look at the bottom of page 24. Now, what the New Testament church or assembly is not. Now, this is right out of the IRS publication 1828. An organization is defined by the courts and the Internal Revenue Service, such as a nonprofit corporation, an unincorporated association, a corporation sole, or a charitable trust. Now, in this trumpet, I have an article here, IRS, all churches, according to the IRS, all churches are under their control. You need to read this article. Now, what I want to talk to you today for a few minutes here is what is an unincorporated association. We'll talk to you about this unincorporated association. Everybody knows what a corporation is. Oh, we don't want to be corporate. We don't want to be incorporated. Well, what about the association? What about the association? The unincorporated church, according to what I just read to you out of that book, and right here in front of me, I have Title 26. They put it into a publication called 1828, and I'm reading to you, and it says, the unincorporated church is considered a legal entity. 501c3 Act 508. Churches and religious organizations may be legally organized under state law, including as unincorporated associations, nonprofit corporations, corporations sole, and charitable trusts. So if you are not a corporation, you're not a corporation soul, and you're not a charitable trust, then they say they consider you and an incorporated association. The association is one of the four recognized IRS-approved churches. In other words, you have to have a distinct legal existence. So, if you're an unincorporated association, the IRS says you're one of these distinct legal you have a distinct legal existence. They recognize you. In other words, what does that mean? That means that the members of your church, if they give a gift, they can get a tax exemption. There's nothing you can do about it. Now, if the IRS comes back on it and you don't verify, the IRS doesn't have to honor it. That's where the rub comes in. The IRS doesn't have to honor it. But they can find it. Because if the IRS has not specifically removed your tax exemption, there's nothing they can do about it. Now let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. In our situation, in May of 1995, the IRS officially removed our tax exemption. Bible, one of the men of our church, he and his wife, sued the IRS. They said, we gave a certain amount of money to the Indianapolis Baptist Temple and we want our tax exemption. We want to receive our deduction from our 1040 form. The IRS says, go fly a kite. And they went to tax court. How many have heard of Start Church, this organization called Start Church? Hold up your hand. Do any of you get that through your email? It's called Start Church. It's like this Chitwood. It's sort of like that organization. Well, they just had that case the other day and put it out on the internet. They lost their case. Because you cannot give a tax-deductible gift to the Annapolis Baptist Temple. Because they removed our tax deduction. But an association that's not incorporated, if they've not officially removed your tax deduction, you're an association, you're a legal church. Unless you're organized, like for instance, that's why we use the Declaration of Trust, which is not a trust. Now they lied about it. They said, well, it's a trust. It is not a trust in the sense of a trust in the normal sense. It's a declaration when we declare our pastor to be able to operate on our behalf. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. If somebody came to town and they said, Wally Drake is a thief. Well, Wally wouldn't have to get up every day like Nixon and said, I'm not a thief. But at least one time, publicly, like maybe in print, which would be best, you would have to make a declaration that you are not a thief. Because if you do not do that, their accusation stands, so to speak. Well, that, and I'm explaining it very simply, that's what it is. The IRS has said, the association is a legal entity. With the declaration, you're making a declaration, a public declaration, that this church is not what the IRS says it is. That's what you're doing, among other things. And it declares that the pastor has the authority to act on behalf of the church. Which takes you out of that position of being an association, and it declares you to be a New Testament church. That's the purpose of it. Now, we've used it for 30 years, ever since Nebraska, with great success, I might say. And we have the evidence of that. I can give you a long list of things. And since I took the Biblical Law Center in 2004, we have either organized or reorganized over 70 churches. We just had three churches called this week. Now, let me read this to you. The difference between an exception and an exemption. Now, everybody keeps saying, our church is exempt. No. Churches are not automatically exempt. Let me explain it. This is right out of publication 1828. It's all in that book. It's all in that book, okay? Section 501c3 describes charitable organizations, including churches and religious organizations, which qualify for exemption from federal income tax and generally are eligible to receive tax-deductible contributions. You will notice that the exemption isn't automatic. The church must qualify by meeting and maintaining the same standards set up for tax-exempt organizations. Churches, quote, churches that meet the requirements of Internal Revenue Code IRC Section 501c3 are automatically considered exempt and are not required to apply for and obtain recognition of tax exempt status from the IRS. However, even though churches are generally eligible to receive tax deductible contributions, to qualify for tax exemption, such organizations must meet the following requirements, close quote. In other words, you are only exempt if you meet the requirements. What requirements? The same requirements that the incorporated boys have to meet. The same requirements that the 501c3 church has to meet. So there's no difference between 501c3 and 508. There's no difference between the corporate church and the association. You have to meet the same requirements. I'm going to give you one example, just one. Let's say that, a church has a dear brother that's running for county commissioner. And he comes to the pastor and he says, Pastor, I'm running for county commissioner. I'd like to give my testimony, my Christian testimony in the church. And the pastor said, well, that'd be nice. I'd like for you to give your testimony in the church. But the problem is, this fellow running against you is a sodomite. And if I let him give his testimony, if I let you give your testimony, I'll have to let him give his testimony. And I'm not going to let that sodomite get in this pulpit. So I'm sorry, brother, I can't let you. I'll be happy to let the people know you're running. But I cannot let you come and give a testimony in our church. But the Indianapolis Baptist Temple, they're not a legal church. Now, for the He wouldn't care. But then they'd be never seen. He'd let them come up here and give testimony. Because he operates as an illegal church. That make a difference. But the normal situation, they're not going to do it. Because they're not going to take a chance. Why? Because they have trustees in that church.
Yep.
And the trustees of that church are legally responsible for that church.
That's it.
And they're going to say to the pastor what David Gibbs said to me 25 or 30 years ago. He said, we have a new brand of trustees now that are educated, that understand their fiduciary responsibility. What was he saying? Well, back in the old days when we basically had uneducated men serving in these positions, they weren't educated. They didn't understand their fiduciary responsibility. But we've got college people now that understand their fiduciary responsibility. And they're not going to be trustees in these churches and let preachers just run these churches like the way they run want to run them. In other words, times have changed. And a moderate-sized church today needs almost a full-time man just to keep the records, the financial records of a church, making sure that they keep all of the demands that the IRS demands of churches today. Why? Because they're legal churches. They're legal churches. I just want a couple of more things and we'll be through. I appreciate your patience. Appreciate your kindness. I want to say once again that our battle was not a tax issue. It was never a tax issue.
Sure.
If it was a tax issue, all we had to do was pay the tax. If it was a tax issue. First place, it wasn't a tax issue because we didn't owe any taxes. There were no taxes owed. The IRS admitted we didn't owe any taxes. Secondly, it was not a tax issue. Because the IRS said all we had to do was sign the exemption form and they'd go away. Don't you understand that Congress passed a law in 1984 that all we had to do was sign an exemption form and we didn't have to pay the FICA tax withholding. All we had to do was pay it. Sign an exemption form. And not only that, Metzger, U.S. Attorney Metzger, before in oral arguments before the court in Chicago, he said to the judge, he said, we can't let these people win, in essence. He said, this is the crux of the whole issue. The crux of the whole issue. He said, why, if these people would win, no church in America would have to get a license for anything. That's what he said. He told the three-judge panel in Chicago. He said, why, if this church would win, he said, no church in America would have to get a license for anything.
Amen.
Can you imagine? Everything, don't you understand that everything was riding on our case? We threw the dice and lost. Don't you understand that? That's what Metzger said. And he read the resolution Brother Sullivan, you read the resolution. It's in that book. You read the resolution about that we passed in our church about inspections, about fire and health and licensure, about all of that. He read it. And that wasn't even the issue. He read that resolution to that three-judge panel, and he said, if you rule against the government and this church wins, you've opened Pandora's box.
Yeah.
It's all over. Basically, he said, it's all over. It's all over. I want to close, Brother Homer, by talking briefly about Brother Homer. I hope all of you will read about Brother Hogan in this trumpet. And then on the inside, you'll read about who betrayed Kent Hogan. Who betrayed Kent Hogan? The Lord Jesus said that the day will come that your own man will be betrayed by his own family. By the way, the proverb says, who lays in your own bosom? Samson found that out, didn't he? Yeah. Brother Kent Hovind is back in jail out of the federal penitentiary. He's been there 8 years. He is in the Santa Rosa County Jail in Milton, Florida. Why is he there? Because he filed frivolous lawsuits that encumbered the government. Brother Homer, you know something about that, don't you? There have been some people around here that did that, right? Didn't they put a fella in the stress ward or the who's that fellow's name?
Amos Lamb.
What?
Amos Lamb.
Amos. Is Amos coming over, you think?
I expected him to be here, hadn't heard from him. But yes, the judge turned him over to the psychiatrist, and the psychiatrist, we've got a tape on it in there, said that this man is...
Yeah, come up here. Will you come up here briefly and close out with that, and then close out any way you want to, but... We need to get a resolution before we leave here. We need to get a resolution from this group supporting Brother Hogan. And I wonder, Brother Boys, if you and maybe get with somebody else, maybe you could get with somebody. Would you be willing to help us on this to get a resolution together supporting Brother Hovind? Could you do that for us and help us on that? It's in the trial. All the information is in this trumpet. Could you help us on that? Put something together. It wouldn't have to be real elaborate.
Yes,
exactly. All right, thank you. I knew you'd be willing to do that if I volunteered. Because you're so kind and nice. And I knew you'd be willing to do that. And besides that, you're educated.
Oh, yeah.
The rest of us are ignorant. And I knew you were going. And I thought if I'd brag on you a little bit, especially because I knew Ellen would help you. Because she's the smart one in the family. And by the way, Brother Joey's back there, and I think he'd help you too. He's right behind you, and I think he'd help you too. Okay. Tell that story then, close that up.
Okay. When Brother Dixon asks you to do something, you might as well just say yes. I learned that a long time ago. Amos Lamb was, he was a man that came to our freedom school, and he doesn't have a social security number, never had one, doesn't have a driver's license, drives all over the country. When he gets arrested, he goes to jail, and he starts teaching the people in the jail how to plead not guilty and tie up the court and so forth, and they get tired of that and pull him out of jail. And they get where they won't have him. They pull him over and they find out it's Amos Lamb. They let him go. We don't want him.
And one county had it and called the county where he's from, said, take him to jail, said, we don't want him.
Yeah.
He said, I'll take him to the county line for you. No, we don't want him. That type of fellow, you know, but the judge over at Murray, Leslie Furches, I think was her name, when he was in there for not having a driver's license, driving without a license, she had a psychologist to examine him. Psychologist said, he's all right, nothing wrong with him. He believes in the Bible, but he's like anyone else, you know, he's all right. But then they called a psychiatrist. And psychiatrists from South America. And the psychiatrist said, yes, he's mentally ill. And I heard him say these words. He said, if you'll turn him over to us, we can change the way he thinks. And the judge said, you can change the way he thinks. Yes. He believes the Bible. He's mentally ill because he believes the Bible. And so she turned him over to the psychiatrist. They put him in Hopkinsville, mental institution. Nothing wrong with Amos. Amos called me from the hospital over there, and he said three men had come in and give him a shot. And he made them tell him what it was, and he said, Thiolol. And Amos has never taken medication. He doesn't believe in it. But he was breaking down. Something was wrong. I could tell the way he's talking. So we went over and did a court of divine justice on the courthouse steps over Murray, Kentucky. Now, a newspaper reporter called me and asked me about this court of divine justice, what we were planning on doing. I explained to him what it was, what it was going to do. He called the sheriff and told him that we were coming, and they set up a SWAT team up on the roof of the courthouse. We arrived, D.O. Smith was with me there, we had several that went. They shut the courthouse down as soon as we got there, they locked it down. And we went ahead with our court of divine justice and tried the judge and prosecutor. And it made the newspapers, the newspaper had it. So they sent and got him out of the mental ward and brought him back to jail. They would have killed him. I'm convinced of that. If we had not done this.
Right.
They were going to make him believe what they wanted him to believe. That was what they were going to do. But they did not expect someone to come and stand for him like that, and did get publication of him. By the way, I called Frankfurt to the department, head of the Justice Department there in Frankfurt, to Adam Trotman, who they are. He told me, he said, this judge will not be judge next term. The election coming up. But how did he know there was an election and she was defeated? Now, I don't know what he meant when he said that she would no longer be a judge after this election, but he knew that she wouldn't. But I'm telling you, if our courts can, which that's exactly the same thing they did in Russia.
Right. Yeah, that's right.
And this happened, I don't know how many years ago, you know, it was 10, 12 years ago.
It's been in the 90s.
90s, I guess, when it took place. And that's right over in Murray, Kentucky, where it takes place. So understand what you are facing, all right?
Amen.
All right, we're going to break for evening meal. We got a good meal for you over there tonight. We're coming back at 6:30. There'll be a song fest. And good news, Brother Greg, you're going to be the main speaker tonight. And we're going to give you a little extra time. Brother Clay Nuttall, of course, did not make it. He's in the hospital praying for him. So we're going to let you make up the difference. Can you do that?
Yes.
Can you preach long enough of that?
Yes.
I know you can. All right, this then we'll be dismissed, and let's go and get some food in us tonight, and let God bless the meal that we're about to take. Brother Paul Davis, would you ask the Lord to bless our food and fellowship for tonight?
Again, Father, we thank you. I guess we could spend all day long just saying thank you.
Yes.
For all that you've done through the course. We know we have to stand back and say, God, can you use us again, please?
Yes.
Our nation is in distress.
Yes, Lord.
We need more men. We need more precious ladies to stand beside our men. We thank you for the opportunity to gather together, regardless of the size, just to let the rest of America know that there are still men around that desire to follow your leadership, desire to know your wisdom, desire to be able to edify and help those that look for help. But, dear Lord, for this local, independent, Bible-believing church, we want to say thank you for it.
Yes.
For all the work these precious ladies have done in preparing our food.
Yes, Lord.
We're most grateful to them, dear Lord. We want you to give a special blessing to them. Let them rest in such a manner that they know nothing how it happened, but just because they've done this hard work and to feed these men and ladies. Thank you for the food. We ask that be strength to our bodies, that we can continue to go on and say, praise God.
Yes.
To God be the glory.
Amen.
Great things He hath done. And Lord, we want you to do some more great ones. So we thank you for today. Thank you for this food. And use us now in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
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 Okay.
Thank you.